church participate in the masses while the congregation entered the main church. And there were two levels, the ground floor, as you can see today, and the first floor resting on the columns, which are today not having anything. So that was the first floor. And we know that this convent had over 100 nuns living at its peak and at its glory. Yeah, so the museum is located within this space. And of course, you're looking at an image of the upgraded museum. So many of us have seen the museum over the years, but this is a recent upgradation of the museum and a must see. So the Mocha highlights. The Museum of Christian Art has a rich collection of art objects produced from the 16th to the 20th century during the Portuguese period in Goa. And it was originally intended for churches, convents, and private dormitories. The collection includes paintings, textiles, sculptures in wood and ivory, silver and gold objects, jewelry, and furniture. Before the arrival of the Portuguese in Goa in 1510, there was already a well-established Goan school of art, represented by families or groups with close interaction with prevailing artistic trends who received royal patronage to produce images, sculptures, paintings of local deities. During the early period of the Portuguese rule, images and other objects of Christian liturgy, as well as furniture and artifacts of daily life, were brought from Portugal and other places in Europe. But as they were not sent in large quantities, local artists were commissioned to create new items to meet increasing demand. Over time, unique art objects were produced not only to meet the local needs, but also intended to be shipped abroad. The silversmiths, goldsmiths, and woodcarvers imprinted their own Indian style on these productions, giving rise to a synthesis of two different cultures, embodied in a substantial part of what has been later recognized or today recognized as Indo-Portuguese art. Just to show you some of the highlights that we have. This is an 18th century silver image of infant Jesus, savior of the world. This image of infant Jesus shows two independent styles, one purely European, the infant Jesus, and the other, the Indo-Portuguese base, that merges harmoniously. The European characteristic includes the infant's anatomical form and technical details, such as the use of silver-plated tin on the body. The image's base comprises a globe on a silver-clad wood. And the Indian elements are evident in the goldsmith's treatment of the serpent with overlapping scales wrapped around the sphere. And water leaf plant forms, shell designs, nagas stand out on the already Indianized piece. You can't see it very clearly, but at the base there are this half-human, half-coiled body like that of a snake, which we call today in the Portuguese art, we call them nagas. And we all know nagas were Hindu divinities, but start to feature in our church altars, pulpits, furniture, liturgical vessels right from the 16th century. So these are the Indian influences on the Christian art. So this is one example. A 20th century ivory image of the Virgin Mary. This ivory depiction of the Virgin Mary is very interesting in the way that it associates Christian and Hindu themes. The Virgin is shown standing on a crescent moon, but also rising from a lotus. The Virgin is, she's draped in a sari, and it's significant is the dove of the Holy Spirit and the crescent moon, which tells us about the Christian iconographic representations in this particular ivory sculpture. This is a 17th century image of Jesus, the Good Shepherd. Many of us have seen images of the Good Shepherd, sometimes with the Tree of Life, beautiful ivory carved images. This one is from the Mocha collection. He depicts a young lad, Jesus as the young lad, in sheepskin. And there are sheep around his feet and on his shoulder. And there's this terraced hillock. Yeah? From the upper level is a face representing the font of life, from whose mouth the water of life gushes into a basin, from which birds of paradise drink. A On the lower level is a figure of a holy penitent performing penance in a cave. Lush green foliage, symbolic of the tree of life, could have been part of the original but is now lost. So also to mention that this is all carved out of one single piece of ivory. There are no extra joints in this particular object. It's all carved out of one piece. So some carvings even behind, we don't have an image of the back to show you. So these are some of the highlights in the collection. We have many more, but let's come and speak about the topic for today, being All Saints Day. We'll talk about one of Goa's most important saints, Saint Francis Xavier. The ships that survived the long and dangerous journey from Lisbon to Goa throughout the modern age brought soldiers, merchants and missionaries to the Indian shores. Among them came Francis Xavier. Born in 1506 in Navarra, Spain, Francis Xavier met Ignatius of Loyola when he was at the university in Paris. Most of us know of the journey of the life of Francis Xavier and where they met, where he met Ignatius Loyola and his other companions with whom he formed the Society of Jesus. This is a human veil from the collection. I've shown it here because of the most important IHS, which is the logo of the Jesuits. So when they formed the Society of Jesus, they took this as their main symbol. So can we go to the next slide? The triangle of Christ, three nails surmounted by a cross as the emblem of their order. And this emblem appears on buildings built by the Jesuits, the liturgical objects and textiles such as this 18th century jewelry. Francis Xavier sailed to India in 1541 under the authority of, given the approval from Ignatius of Loyola to do so, and the Pope and the King of Portugal. During the next 10 years, Goa would be the base for Francis Xavier's work in regions covering the Coromandel Coast, Malacca, Japan and other places in Asia. The King of Portugal also sought the services of the members of the Society of Jesus to work in America and Africa. So here we have the representation of a ship, of a boat. It's meant to be an incense boat, but just to talk about why the incense boat and why is it in the form of a boat. It's basically a container, but we believe that the seafarers and the completion of a successful voyage would offer something to the church in thanksgiving. And here we have a fine example from the Basilica of Bom Jesus. So just to connect the seafaring and the naveta. Coming to the museum displays connected to the life of Francis Xavier. Most of these objects are from the Basilica of Bom Jesus, which the museum is now featured in the museum. Originally when the museum was set up, we had people who were associated with the museum who identified these pieces as being representative of Indo-Portuguese art and representative of our unique Christian heritage in Goa to be part of the museum. So this is a reliquary coffer. It's made of wood and completely covered in chased silver. It's decorated with curling plant motifs that adorn the front and coffer top in low relief. And it's arranged symmetrically as in a fabric design. So just to give you a side glance, so we look at the front. On the side there is a miracle which is carved out in silver low relief. So what is this miracle? One of the coffer's side, as the craftsman depicts miracles performed by the saint. One about raising a dead man, possibly an Eastern priest, and another alluding to help given to the vicar of Malacca, where the saint is said to have driven away the demons persecuting him at the hour of death. Delicate silver work at the back of the coffer informs us of the contents it once held, a piece of a surplice or vestment worn by St. Francis Xavier. Two narrow tablets that flank the central medallion containing the triangle of Christ, a cross and the nails. The right one reads, Sobre Pelis, Don San Francisco Xavier, on the other side.
So I think sometimes the back is more interesting than the front. And like this example, it gives us so much of information of what this reliquary coffer contained at one point in time. This is another object. It's an altar car. According to popular belief, St. Francis Xavier was once caught in a storm. And of course, we all know of this miracle of the crab and the cross, where he is said to have calmed the storm by putting his cross into the sea. And the storm and the sea is calmed down, but he loses his cross in the process. And how, when he reaches the shores, there is a crab that brings in his claws the cross. So this represents that miracle of the crab and the cross. And as a base of this, we see it's an altar car with some prayers. Many of us don't even know what the altar cars are. And in our generation, we don't see them being used. So we wonder what are altar cars. And of course, we have so many priests here among us who would be able to explain better. But just to say it in simple words, earlier when masses were said in Latin, the altar cards were placed at the altar with the most important prayers that would need to be said, which would facilitate the priest. And these have now fallen into disuse because we say the masses in the vernacular, and some of them are now either deteriorated or neglected or just lost. So this is one fine example of an altar car that we have in the museum's collection, and of course connected to a miracle of St. Francis Xavier. So you can look at it up close. You can see the claws of the crab and the cross. This is not from our collection, but I wanted to show you another depiction of the crab and the cross. This is from Portugal, from the College of Jesus in Coimbra, and it's currently at the Museum of Machado de Castro in Coimbra. Votive flowers. So I think many a times people would like the incense board. There were other things that people also offered at the basilica, and one of these, we have two votive plaques. One is the right, his image, and they are a modern workmanship, were probably made or given by the same silversmith or donor whose name is inscribed on the plaque as P.S. Dastur in 1925. So the date is not visible here, but the name and the date are inscribed right at the top of this plaque. So we know St. Francis Xavier holds a cross and a staff. We also know that once his relics were placed in the silver tomb, there used to be a commemorative staff that was kept there, and because it was believed that he is the protector of Goa, and because of him there are no severe attacks or no calamities and tragedies that hit Goa. But how did this practice start of keeping this commemorative staff at his tomb? It is said that during the Portuguese times, during the Maratha, there was an invasion from the Marathas, and the Portuguese governor, who had this commemorative staff that used to be offered to every governor who entered the city of Goa, would take this stick. Took the stick at that moment when there was an imminent threat from the Marathas. He takes the staff and places it in the tomb of Francis Xavier and says, "You are the true protector of Goa and you should protect us." And at the same time, you have Aurangzeb and the Mughal emperor attacking the Marathas from the other side, and the Marathas retreat from their attack of Goa. And from that day onwards, we have these commemorative staffs that were kept by every subsequent governor, Portuguese governor of Goa. So here we have a representative staff and a cross. So we know that St. Francis Xavier died on the 3rd of December 1552 on the Siachen Island, while awaiting permission to enter mainland China. His body was shifted to Malacca in February of 1553 and subsequently shipped to Goa. It was kept at St. Paul's College, which is now in ruins. After his canonization, in 1622. His body was moved to the Basilica of Bon Jesus in 1624, where it lies to this day in a silver coffin. The coffin has 32 plates carved with scenes depicting the life and the miracles of St. Francis Xavier. We are not as privileged to look at those silver plates up close, but this is an image from 1952 by the photographer James Burke, where it shows the silver casket lowered down and the devotees venerating the relics of St. Francis Xavier. This is the other votive plaque that was a set of two, the first one we saw a little earlier. And this votive plaque depicts the same investments lying in the coffin, which is framed with a molding of stylized branches that become denser towards the top. Can we move to the next slide? Maybe it's closer. Yes. And it's surmounted by a cross at the top. There's a dove of the Holy Spirit, two praying angels in long gowns adorn the framed sides. The saint's name appears on one side in a frame there at the base of the plaque. So we don't know who P.S. Dastur was and when it was given, because it was not given in the year of the exposition. They say there was no exposition in 1925, but he must have visited or must have had prayed for some kind of a favor which got, which materialized for him, which was, there was a miracle in his life, and maybe he offered these votive plaques to the Basilica. The tomb of St. Francis Xavier is constructed of marble. We know, we've seen many a times when we visited the Basilica, and consists of three steps or stages besides the silver coffin. Here in the museum we have a model of the tomb of St. Francis Xavier, and this was made as recently as 1964, says 20th century, but we know the date was 1964, by the master craftsman Vamona Zong. I feel very proud because in this case we know who the artist is. The rest of the collection at MoCA, we don't know who these artists were, but in this case at least we know because his name is engraved at the on the wooden part of this beautiful model. And this was commissioned by Mr. Percival Noronha, and it was Vamona Zong who executed this model of the tomb of Francis Xavier in ivory. It's a beautiful example of what is there in reality in the Basilica. And with this, I'll end the presentation because this is what we have connected to the life. The objects are in the museum, but right now not on display. They'll soon be coming up on display. We've done partly our installation, and some parts are yet to be completed. But do come and visit the museum. But we move to the last slide.
The audio is not playing. Oh. Open the mic.
Can you just like that? So I played this hymn of Safrasi Shavira, which is written by Raimund Barreto and set to music, and he conducted the first rendition of this hymn. He composed the hymn in fulfillment of a vow that he made to the saint after the latter's intercession is said to have miraculously saved him from drowning. So just to, for it to be audible, I don't know how it can come on the speaker. Let's put it on the mic. Let's try this one. It was meant to be a hymn that we've all heard before, dedicated to St. Francis Xavier. This was a rendition by the very famous Goan choir, Aradon. Most of us have heard them. And thank you. But I wanted it to be a brief presentation because if any of you have questions or want to know more about the collection, especially dedicated to St. Francis Xavier, we can now open it to the Q&A. Thank you.